What's going on, you loyal listeners? Thank you for tuning in to the L Squared Podcast. I'm your host here, Luke Larson, and joining me today, I have two extremely special guests, two lovely ladies here. We're here to talk about their film. I have Candy and Lulu from the new film Blood 13. Thank you guys so much for coming on the show.
Thank you for having
us.
Yes. Hello. So, we met over the wonderful invention we call the internet. You know, you guys reached out and you wanted to see if we would watch this film and talk about it, and I was more than happy to do it. So Blood 13, do you guys kind of want to give us sort of a synopsis of kind of the plot and kind of what this movie's all about?
I think I will go there. My name is Candy Lee. I'm the director of Blood 13. This is a suspense thriller that the story is happening in China, and we shot in China. It's a story about a reckless detective, a female detective who Lulu plays, who is chasing after a serial murderer whose targets are the prostitutes. And in the beginning, that the female detective is a little bit prejudiced against the group of female the prostitutes, but as she continues to investigate the cases with the old detective Lao Zhou and her assistant Mei Shuo, she starts to understand the importance of finding the serial murderers, and she starts to conquer her inner prejudice and inner fear. So this is what the story is.
I think the name is very difficult for the audience.
We talked about that a little bit at the beginning, yeah. So,
And I'm the female policeman.
Yes. The wonderful actress, Lulu.
Thank you.
Absolutely. Really great performance. From you, and you really, it really comes across the, you know, like you said, the word reckless comes up, and the, you know, there's a lot of tenacity there. And I thought you did a great job portraying it. Really great acting across the board. I thought I loved the older gentleman, kind of the seasoned detective. I thought he was fantastic. He was probably my favorite character.
You have seen the movie.
Yeah.
I can tell you, Lulu in person is definitely not that kind of.
Yeah.
Very happy and stupid.
Well, that's why she's a great actress, right?
Yeah, no, we actually had another Q&A before, and Lulu happened to be there, and all the people were not believing that this little girly, giggly person is
That's great.
That's cute.
Well, the quiet ones, the nice ones, are the ones you got to watch out for, right?
Yeah. Even the first 10 minutes, one of my friends, he didn't recognize me for the character, and after 10 minutes, he said, "Where's you?" This is me.
That's me. So what led you both to this project? How did this project come about?
I meet Candy by a very coincidence. Before I should go to Europe to shoot another movie in Paris, and I know I have the project already that haven't signed, which I just want to meet her and maybe say hi, and then I know I don't have the time to do this project, maybe, but when we meet each other, we just not like fall in love, but it's like, very happy to talk with her, and I think we should have a very happy time during shooting, too. So I just want, there have a song in my heart that says, do it, how can I change it? So it just makes a funny things, and I find very cute excuse for I can't go to Europe. I said I need the iPhone. Yes, we have. I can't go. I can't leave Taiwan. I need the time zone.
Yeah,
and then the minister doesn't care.
he was in Europe.
Yeah,
On my side, I've always loved Lulu. Like, I know Lulu as a actress from her kind of debut film, Flying Mountain, that went to Cannes in,
2007.
So I already knew Lulu as a great actress, and then I also really, really love her performance in one movie called Blind Massage, where she plays a prostitute.
Wow.
I think she was amazing in both films, and she definitely has long time become the actress that I've been willing to work with. And then I got the script, and I was like, I don't know if she can do it because she must be so busy. And actually, in her movies before, she always portrays as very like arrogant, a little bit like scary. Mm. So I was really scared to approach her. but when I first met her through our casting director, she was so bright and happy, and we just hit it off. So it was really great that I got to have her in here. So
yeah. And I think that, do you think that chemistry kind of helped grease the wheels? I think there was definitely a level of comfortability that came across, you know. Do you think that is that how you prefer to work?
And in fact, we had very happy time together during the shooting. Mm-hmm. Even the situation is very difficult. Every day we shoot like 16 hours. So if we don't like each other, it will be...
That would make those 16 hours even longer, right? Yeah.
I mean,
this is definitely a tough shoot. There were a lot of moving parts, and we were on location most of the time. And very cold, and it was long hours in China. That's how there's no rules of how you can shoot. There's no turnaround. So it was a tough time for us, but because we really hit it off. So
yeah.
And Lulu is such a chill actress. So I was blessed to have her, because I wouldn't make this film without her pretty much.
No. That's great.
But I think I bring you a lot of happiness on the location.
Yes, we're giggling in on location, like looking at the core.
like the children playing on the location.
Yeah,
even the bleeding everywhere.
Blood everywhere.
You guys were just having the time of your lives out there.
Yeah, totally.
So, Candy, is this your first feature film, correct?
Yes, I actually shot like a TV film before.
Okay.
I was just it was like on demand, so I didn't go theatrical at all, and so that was like a practice for me. This one definitely was I would like to take as my debut of my career.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
So, I mean, what were some big lessons you learned from making this your debut in this, you know, this feature for the first time, apart from the TV movie?
Right. I studied film here in the U.S. and I got a job just like as a producer right afterwards to make some money.
Sure.
But I definitely want to be a director as a profession. So I got this script. It was from a friend who is actually a female police. Mm. And she told me a lot of story about how the police force in China, there were some parts that they're not as like glorious as they see. Like, there are still female police who might be, you know, a little reluctant to chase for the serial killer because it's really hard to, or they might have a different image than what what they're portrayed. So that was like a really interesting script that I read in the beginning. But I was really preparing to do that, and we were trying to find money and everything. It was all completely self-funded. But the problem is we were working with a partner who dropped like a little bit before the shoot.
Oh, wow.
So we were struggling with money, and then everything was already booked, and Lulu's time was very limited, so we kind of have to shoot almost like less than three months since I read the script.
Wow.
So it was everything in a hurry. if anything lesson learned, I would take more time in prep and make the script a little more refined. So that everything when we're shooting we would be a little more planned out. So
my auntie saw the movie, said, "Oh, the before, like a half part before is so perfect."
Yeah.
But the end is a little bit, because you guys don't have money, okay, yes. We were definitely under a lot of limits. I mean, money is definitely a big issue.
Sure.
That limits us with the artistic choices of the film. That's just the common knowledge for every production. I don't believe any production thinks that they had enough time.
Right.
But what we were facing was more extreme. But I was told that that's the natural one filming in China. So, I would hope the next one with Lulu already, we're already friends, we can build up something a little bit lower and more refined.
Right. Yeah, and maybe, could be, there's the classic story of the Bourne trilogy, with Paul Greengrass and how they didn't have a finished script for when they started shooting for Bourne Supremacy, and I think also Bourne Ultimatum. So they were just kind of doing it as they went. And I think that urgency really translates on screen. I think it translated in Blood 13 as well. And I think that adds... But yeah, so I think that urgency really... It came across in the Bourne films, and I think it helped in Blood 13. I think that energy kind of translated. But I'm kind of curious how, like, kind of what your origin story is. So you said you went to USC, right, to film school. But what led you to that point? I mean, what kind of sparked your love of film and wanting to pursue it as a career?
I've always loved film. I think I always want to direct and, make up my own stories and tell the world about it. But I think I was in China for high school, and then my parents said, "Oh, there's a school in America that is really good for filmmakers if you want to apply." And I was like, "Yes, I would totally love to apply for it." Yeah. I don't know if I could make it because it's a different world. Mm. But I think I was really interested in English subjects in high school, so I just applied, and luckily I got in. So I think this is an encouragement for my career, that I think, okay, at least what I turned in, some people were interested in the stories I told, so I should just keep on telling this story, and this is it.
Yeah, well, I couldn't agree more, and I can't wait to see more of the stories that you have to tell.
Thank you.
Yeah, absolutely. And Lulu, I kind of have, if I could just kind of throw the same question to you, but what made you want to be an actress and be in films?
I'm sorry. When I was in high school, I want to be a singer. But then I find it's so difficult in China, I was studying mathematics, because my whole family were like a nuclear research like a scientist.
Oh, wow.
Scientist. Yeah, so they think actress is not a real job. My father was angry with me.
Oh, no.
Yeah, so I still went to a normal university in Sichuan, in my hometown. And then I find I really like movies.
Mm.
And I quit the first university to Beijing Film Academy. But I must quit the first one, then I can get the exam for the second one. So my father thinks I'm crazy. The half year, he don't want to talk with me.
Oh,
so man. I enter Beijing Film Academy. Because he never believed I can pass by the exam. It's so difficult, like, mm. You wonder, 10,000 can choose 30 person 1 year for Beijing Film Academy. So when I entered Beijing Film Academy, I just find, yeah, first I'm happy. Then I realized I know nothing about performing. So after half year, I was depressing.
Oh, no.
And I want to quit again. And my father says, no, you can't quit. Again, otherwise you only can go to NYU. Okay, I insist. So until the first year, I didn't find my confidence for performing. Until I went to the first real movie shooting, because in the Beijing Film Academy, the teacher always teach us like performing on stage. So I feel weird that to speak too loudly and the kwajang, the artificial. I like to do detailed performing, like very sensitive performing before the camera.
Yeah.
But in the stage, I feel I have no confidence. So after the first movie I shoot, I find my confidence for performing. Before, I just thought I'm not shoot for actress.
Yeah.
Also, my teacher said that.
Oh, no.
Yeah, so after the first movie shooting, I find, oh, I belong to movie. Then
the
I finished my first May actress movie, Blind Mountain, went to the Cannes Film Festival, and I totally, like, know what is the right way I should go. So.
Yeah. So just kind of the more subtlety with film acting as opposed to acting on stage was more your style. Yeah. That's interesting.
Yeah, but after 10 years I went back to stage performing last year.
Hmm.
But I still can find some interesting things that maybe I have confidence now, so I can go back.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's probably a lot of it. And I maybe you both could speak to this, but I'm kind of interested how the industry is different where you guys are from in China as opposed to like LA and Hollywood.
In China, I never shoot TV series before. I always shoot movie, and I work with European industry too.
Mm.
Even in Dubai, Sri Lanka, everywhere.
Oh, wow.
I work with more than 20 different countries, directors. I think the performing for movie, it the director is good, the way it's the same for performing. Yeah, I think, but the time is different. In China, we have maybe 24 hours shooting. No sleep.
Wow.
And the Europe, they must have afternoon tea.
Right, I've heard about that,
Have one day off every week. When
wow.
I was shooting in London, it's the first time I know they have weekends. But every time when I finish shooting, the shopping mall also closed. Because they closed at like 6 p.m. 7 p.m. every day.
What?
I don't know who can shopping in that area. Nobody walks there. So one day I just finished working, like I only have 15 minutes to go shopping. So So I just got it quickly. So I just treat it like traveling everywhere while shooting in other countries. And here, I think it's much better. Studio.
The malls are open later here.
Yeah, 2 days off and have trailer. Very good food every day.
Yeah, in China, you would have to, even the cat would have to just, like, indie film, sorry. With, during lunch break, you would probably just, like, grab a lunchbox and
sit. Yeah.
Where in here, you have so many courses of catering. It's very different.
Now, some commercial Chinese movie are much better. Like I shoot a movie last year, it's like almost like here, almost, but still not.
But still, they probably wouldn't have. They would still have a 7 day week.
Yeah, they probably. But they have. Week. They have a trailer for restroom. For toilet. Yeah, that's good. I said, oh, it's good. And the crew have desk. Or chair to sit to have lunch. That's better. Before they just sit on the street, like a fire or something. And someday I saw a mother point to us to his boy said, "Oh, if you don't study hard, you just like this."
Wow.
It's very different. In China, they. I mean, Lulu used to have a lot of artistic films that are like very, very just tough shooting situations. So that's where I've always had. I always encounter too. They don't really. I mean, they really care for the film itself. They don't really care about like taking care of you too well.
Yeah, if you have enough food and I can have a shower, it's okay.
Yeah. So the bottom line. Yeah. So they're in. I mean, as a director working in China, you're like God. Even as a first-time director, I felt I was treated very nicely in terms of all the crew. They don't really care what time they get off. I mean, they hope that you can finish shooting first. But if you don't, nobody can complain. They all just like wait for you. And we were having some overnight shoot, and we were having really. Short turnaround, like a couple of hours turnaround. And I mean, I try not to do that, but sometimes the very limited time and schedule, you just have to finish the job. So I realized in China, it's rarely that the crew will like show a face to you and be like, hey, we gotta go. Like, this is not legal. Nobody said that.
Okay. So I mean, there's nice parts about that, definitely. But one thing I wanted to say, I'm so excited that both of you are on here, and I'm excited to bring this up. But I think that I'd love for you guys to talk about, you know, we're in the past, you know, in the past, say going on about 5 years now, the industry has made a shift to really take more steps with women in film and women directing films and producing films and more female led and more points of view from females, and it's an exciting time. And I would just kind of, you know, I love that you guys are part of that too, and I think it's important. And I don't know if this story would resonate as much if it wasn't told from that you know, from that perspective. But I was wondering if you guys had any thoughts about women, you know, finally starting to take like the industry finally like starting to hoist women up and take their points of view, you know, in a higher regard.
Okay. I think Lulu has to go, so we'll try to finish this one last. And
okay, great.
I think from 10 years ago, I was working with a female director. It was my first time. It was very tough. But Candy is like very sweet way to cooperation with other crew. I think female directors, they have more sensitive feeling about woman's story, especially like a woman female movie. And I love female movies. if there's a movie have no female main actor, I don't want to watch it.
Yeah.
That's what I saw in the past. So I'm really interested about, like, if the two main actors are both similar, better. If the producer and the producer and director are female, that's better. I think women will pay more attention in how women really think and how the story is going. I'm not saying male director is not good, but right. sometimes it's just like a street man, not gay. Mm-hmm. There are two streets. Sometimes something too powerful.
Mm.
So maybe we can't do what we really want, and we're so relaxed.
Mm-hmm. Now we don't listen that much.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, not every male director. I think that some of that, we think the man must have a powerful thing on the location.
Mm.
So I think if female director can direct to a better movie, sometimes you even can see the movies from a female director.
Mm.
I think female director need to do more working, more energy than men. Then they can't shoot like an echo situation. Them, I think they are more difficult to work in this industry. So we should encourage them much better than the male director. The male director already strong enough. So
yeah, we've already heard their point of view for a long time. Yeah.
I think definitely recent years there have been more movements for female director, actor, and stories, like female stories. So I think this is great. I think I hope in the future it's more about who is good, and then it's not just this job is selected to be given to the female because they are female. It's also, right. I hope, because they're good. Because I think that's when the sexism is really going to be distinguished. Because I think there are a lot of female filmmakers out there who probably didn't get a chance to. Like, we're already very lucky to be here. But mm-hmm. first, we need to give them more chances to let them practice, to let them understand, to practice right. their craft. And then I hope in the perspective in the future it will be more that more of them will be practiced enough to right. be good, and then they will be hired. So I think this is just the beginning of the movement, and I'm very happy about this. I personally love, like Lu, I love female characters mm-hmm. driven story, and I love a strong female character because the time is different now. People need to think more progressively.
Yeah.
People need to imagine more about what the future would be like. And more women shouldn't be staying in the kitchen only, you know,
yeah.
they have to be out there and not just take care of the baby, but definitely,
yeah.
you know, do more work. And I think not just like manual or labor work, but more
mm-hmm.
of something that reflects their mental status and their psychological status, because I think that's the very precious part that the world needs to see more, because it's there are great things in there.
Right. Yeah, and absolutely. I think I totally agree. And, you know, it would just be great if we could get to that point where it's not a special thing, or we don't have to go out of our way to boost, you know, or say that, oh, this is female led, or we're empowering women, but get to the point where it's more normal for, you know,
yeah.
less of an oddity for women to be prominent in these films and to have their stories told. And I would love to get that point, but I won't take any more of your guys' time. Thank you guys so much for coming on. Do you have anything you guys want to? Yeah, absolutely.
Thank you. Please watch our films and Amazon iTunes and support us.
Yeah. Absolutely. Do you guys have any plugs? Where can the people find your work and find you guys?
I think Block 13 is already on iTunes, and it will be on Amazon Prime October 20th. So stay tuned.
Okay, great. Well, I will. I'm excited to see. I'm excited to follow both of your guys' career, and I wish you the best. I thank you guys so much for coming on.
Thank you.
Absolutely. Thank you so much. And you guys can find me on Twitter at LukeLarson89. You can find this podcast on Facebook at L2 Podcast, on Twitter at L Squared Podcast, on Instagram at L Squared Podcast. We're on SoundCloud. We're on YouTube. And yeah, give us a shout, follow Blood 13, follow Lulu, follow Candy, go support them, support independent films, support women in film, and follow these guys in their career. They're going to be great. So until next time.